Oh, there we go. Dubster. Can you hear me, Dub? Can you hear the music? My boy, Gene Moore, man. Not there yet. Give everybody a little time to, second, y'all. Good. They'll say, can hear me?
Times in my own way, take no blame for my mistakes. I'm always the victim.
704. Technical difficulty.
But you said you'd never leave. So I'm trying every day.
There we go. Facebook, there we go. What's up, April? What's up, Dub? April, I see you sign, y'all. Sign you. Get people coming up. Get about 30 people. We're gonna go, y'all. But in the meantime, we're gonna meditate on Gene Moore. Not there yet. I wanna thank y'all for joining, man. Appreciate the love, Dre. Appreciate you, brother. Angie White. I see you, Kia. Hola. What's up, Nuke? Amen. Jay Mike, what's up, Nuke? Thank you for joining, man. First time going live. Miss Janice, I appreciate the love. Appreciate the love. We're doing everything else during this pandemic. We're doing everything else. People DJing. My daughter is my little assistant. She's taking the audio video class at Dawson. So that's why I'm gonna put her to work and see if she's actually learned anything. Hey, what's going on? Hey, what's going on, Tam? I see you, Nuke. We just listening to some Gene Moore. Not there yet. But we're trying to get there, y'all. We're trying to get there. Hey, Patricia. Hey, sis. Yeah, that's my boy Gene Moore playing. Actually, you know, one day when I actually discovered this artist, he's a local artist here in Houston. And you know how God worked, you know, maybe a couple days after I discovered him, I ran into him in my gym right here in Pearland. So, you know, there's no such thing as coincidence. So God blessed me with that. I needed that. But anyway, y'all, I think we have enough people. I'm going to go ahead and get started. I think I'm going to open up in prayer, you know, for this Bible study. Like I said, it's my first time going live. I typically do Bible studies on Wednesday. Every Wednesday, men's Bible study. Hey, Tracy, at St. John's downtown. So today I'm doing it from the comfort of my home. During this pandemic, was trying to figure out, you know, something that we could do. I see people, DJs are DJing, comedians are doing live comedy. But a kingdom man, I said, you know, what we need the most, we need to see more of this. So I feel like I have a responsibility, and it definitely was on my heart and something I love to do. What's up, cuz in Indiana? What's up, D. Blaylock? What's up, Derek? But it's just something on my heart, man. And I know we were created for such a time as this, so what more appropriate time to share God's word and what I know in his wisdom, because I'm definitely in pursuit of it. So anyway, I just want to open us in prayer. And if you guys bow your heads and just let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Father. Thank you for the opportunity to speak your words to your people, Father, your people in need in such a time as this, Father. Your word says, if we seek ye first your kingdom and his righteousness, Father, all things will be added unto us, Father. Like I say, seek ye first your kingdom, Father. You say, if we ask, it'll be given. If we seek it, we'll find it. If we knock on the door, it'll be open, Father. In a time like this, Father, we need your help, Father. We need your covenant. We need your coverage, Father. We need you to comfort us, Father. We need you to give those people with little hope. We need to give them great hope, Father. Let them know that in all things we can accomplish through you, through your word, through your ways, through your mysteries, Father. We just focus back on you, Father, at such a time as this, Father. I want to pray that each and every person under my voice, Father, under the sound of my voice, Father, are covered, have great faith, or in good spirits, Father, and know that all things are possible, Father, on your rock, Father. No sand, but on your rock, Father, we can do all things, Father, because your power, you are the Elohim God, Father. You're the powerful God, Father. In all things we can accomplish through you, Father. And we know there's no such thing as coincidence, so we want to get the lesson, Father. Most importantly, we want to figure out what it is you're trying to communicate to us at such a time as this, Father. We want to get that lesson. We have lots of time. We have even less distractions at this time, Father. We're not focused on entertainment, Father, and I know this thing is happening so that we can point back to you, Father, so that we can look at you for our answers, Father, because through you all things are possible, Father. In Jesus' name, Father, in Jesus, your darling son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. What's up, Noob? Oh, man. What's up, LB? What's up, man? This is beautiful, man. This is beautiful. Like I said, it don't matter the audience, but the message is the same message from 2,000 years ago. Hey, Debril, Chicago. What's up, fam? I see you. Yeah, and I just wanted to... It's wild. This morning, typically in the mornings, I do my morning devotional. And this morning, yesterday I decided, man, I need to go live tomorrow. I know everybody, typically we do Bible studies on Wednesdays. But I said, tomorrow, I need to do something, you know, since it's a Tuesday and not as many people having Bible studies. So when I went into my morning devotional this morning, the spirit I took in there was, I said, well, I can do a lesson on Paul, man. You know, Paul's one of my favorite characters in the book because what he's done for my life. But as I was in my morning devotion, in my closet, in the dark, God put a whole new spirit on me, an additional spirit of exactly what he wanted me to communicate. And I just thought it was appropriate at such a time as this. So I'm going to start out with a scripture. Today's scripture, and it's not just a Bible study, really. I think about, you know, even me starting my clothing line and things like that. When I did that, you know, that was good. I thought I was doing something great for the kingdom. You know, blase one means awareness, enlightenment, God, right? Like awareness, enlightenment, God. But what I realized after that is God said, you know, and I told my friend Corey, and Corey tell you, one day he said, Blake, man, you have this great idea, man. Let's really press it and move it forward. And I said, Corey, Dub, I said, man, you know what came to me? God came to me and told me, he said, you know, I see what you're doing, you know, with this clothing brand and trying to, you know, give my kingdom glory. But he said, that's not it. He said, what I need you to do, he said, the clothing line, that's the wagon. But he said, you the horse. So there's no way the wagon pulls the horse. The horse has to pull the wagon. And so with that, I knew what he was communicating to me. What he was communicating to me is that my life had to change. I couldn't just put that out there and remain the same person, but I had to put that out there. I had to live it. I had to be about it. And he had been calling me for 20 years anyway, so I knew exactly what he was communicating. But I definitely had to be about, I had to be the horse. I had to get in front of that. He said, that's just merchandise, but I need you to change your life. I need people to see your life change. I need to see people to see your life grow, to see you grow in my kingdom, in my works. I need to see your heart change. I need to see your heart grow in stronger love towards me and my kingdom. And so, and definitely use people like me because we do things, give big events and lots of people come out and people know my past. And so, you know, use people like that. He uses wretches like me to give people hope because my past, it definitely wasn't easy, you know, and I definitely done a lot of foolish things. But today I'm thankful, you know, I'm very thankful. I'm thankful that he saved my life. Yeah. But anyway, I'm going to read this scripture. We're going to read a scripture. I want to talk a little bit about the scripture from Paul. It's a very powerful scripture for me. And I also want to parallel it back to Exodus. But this particular scripture reading comes from Philippians 3:13. And it reads, it says, "My brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to take hold of it. But one thing I do is I forget my past as I press forward towards my future." I'm going to repeat that. That's Philippians 3:13. It says, "My brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself as have laid hold of it. But one thing I do is forgetting what is behind me as I press forward towards my future." So that's very important. That is that's critical. That right there saved my life. I mean, I live it. You guys, I want to tell you a little bit about Paul, because Paul wrote this scripture to the church of Philippi. This is one of the letters he wrote that actually became a scripture in the New Testament. And when Paul wrote this scripture, he was actually in jail. He was in jail, but he was writing to the church of Philippi. And one thing that people who don't know about the character of Paul, Paul used to be Saul. Saul was a Pharisee, Sadducees. He's a person that's very educated in the word of God, right? He's very educated in the Old Testament, right? He was a Jewish person, circumcised on the 8th day. All Jews were circumcised. And so this is who Paul was. Paul was very, like I said, he knew the Bible. He knew the Bible. He was a Bible-toed joker. He was educated in the Old Testament, the book of Law and Prophets, right? He was educated with the commandments. And what Paul did, Paul actually was also, he became, what he didn't believe was that Jesus, when he came into the New Testament, he was the Messiah. He didn't believe that they were waiting on the Messiah. He didn't believe this ordinary man, this meek, humble man could be the Messiah. And so what Paul did was he persecuted Christians. Paul went out and people, if you are a Christian, Paul was looking for you. He was a bounty hunter. He would go to the post office and intercept letters and try to figure out who was writing letters from jail to see who were Christians so that he can go and bounty hunt you and cut your head off. He had real major zeal. He was on fire in the wrong direction, right? He was on fire in law and legalism, right? Say he's checking the boxes on all the commandments. If you didn't, hey man, I'm getting you. You know, it wasn't no grace, no mercy, no love, right? Because love precedes law, right? That's what the New Testament is versus the Old Testament, right? That's law in the Old Testament. But God came to fulfill the law with love and say, hey, it's way more than that. It's way more than law. You know what I mean? It's about grace, mercy, forgiveness. But the greatest of all things is love, right? And so what Paul did, he was persecuting Christians. And one day he intercepted a letter and he was on his way to Damascus. And on his way to Damascus, God came to him. And he came to him on the streets of Damascus and say, "Paul, why do you persecute my people?" You know, Paul fell down to his knees and lost his sight, right? He was on his way to kill some Christians. And God came to him and said, "Why do you persecute my people?" And so on his way to Damascus, he lost his sight. And so Jesus said, "Well, I'm going to send a man to you in 3 days." And so what he did was Paul made it to Damascus without sight. The guys he was with took him there. And in 3 days, a man came and gave Paul his sight back. And when he gave Paul his sight back, guess what Paul did? Paul gave God his life. So he was going 180 in one direction, and he changed his life when he had this occurrence with God on the road to Damascus, and he went the totally other direction. And I know what God seen in him and what he see in a lot of us is he see the energy, he see our intellect, he see our skills, our talents, our gifts. He see our gifts and he see us using them in the wrong direction, right? But the thing is, he want to use those gifts and use them for his kingdom. Because one thing I realized, because I definitely, you know, he's blessed with lots of talents and gifts and things like that. And to meet lots of people and they're, "Oh, you're a good person, all that's great," right? But that probably won't get you in the kingdom, right? So he used those talents and gifts. He said, "Paul, you got some zeal. You got zeal like no other. If I can take this man and turn him and use him and he can focus on my kingdom and do my work, he can do great things." And that's exactly what Paul did. So the same man who used to persecute Christians, he was a Jewish man. He knew the Bible. He was a religious man, right? He was a Bible-toting religious man who used to persecute Christians, judge people, right? He used him. And when Paul got his sight back, man, Paul was on fire. Paul went into the wilderness for a while. Paul then later, he went out and start evangelizing. You know, he was actually checking Peter, right? Like, "Peter, you guys, you know," Peter was hanging out with some Gentile people eating in their house, and Paul showed up. Peter jumped up like he wasn't with them, right? And Peter, Paul like, "Hey, hold up, that ain't what it's about," right? So Paul was really strong and he really got it, right? He had those words written on his heart. And so what God did, the same man that persecuted Christians, one of the greatest terror stories in the Bible, guess what God used him? He actually wrote 13 books of the Bible. He wrote 13 books in the New Testament, right? He wrote more books in the Bible than any one person. This is what Paul did, the same man that used to persecute Christians. So the more of that story for me, when I see that story, because all God's stories and his examples in the Bible are really audacious. They're really huge to make sure that anything that you might have in that same line of sin is going to be under that cover. Like, nobody suffered more than Job. You can't possibly suffer more than Job. Nobody had more women and more riches and more money than Solomon. And Solomon said, hey, man, I know I had all these women. I had all the money. I drank out of gold cups. I was the smartest. I was the wisest. But I tell you what, there's no meaning in life apart from God. Just like Job's wife said, man, die and curse God and die. Job said, no, even though I'm suffering, we blessed him and praised him in the good times. Why wouldn't we praise him in the bad times? So there was no greater example of suffering than Job. There was no greater abundance than Paul. I mean, than Solomon. There was, for Paul, there was no greater sin, I think, than really looking for Jesus' people to kill him. I mean, who could do something greater than that? But Paul did those things. And when Paul used that same energy, that same zeal that he was using to go in the wrong direction, God used him to write the 13 books of the Bible, Ephesians and Philippi, Romans. I mean, he wrote so many books of the New Testament, right, that we read today. Those are all letters from Paul, the epistles of Paul, right? And so the message in that is that if God can use Paul, and what he wants us to get in that message, that if he can use Paul, he can use anybody. He can use each and every one of you out there. He wants to use each and every one of you out there. Matter of fact, he said those gifts and those talents he gave you all, he didn't give you for your own personal selfish gain to pick up good jobs and material things and relationships. He gave you those talents and gifts to do his work, right? To be a light in this world, right? So that when people see you, they see him. And the thing is, like Matthew 5:14 say, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. And then he said, I'm not going to light you up to put a basket over you. No, matter of fact, that's what it say right here. He said, I'm going to light you up to get light, put you on a lampstand to get light to everybody in the house. He want everybody in the house. He said, Matthew 5:50 say, show your good works before men so they may glorify your Father in heaven. So he wants all of us to be a light. And he wanted Paul to be a light. Like, Paul used that word and turned it and ran 5 million miles with it. We still talking about Paul today just because of the change in his life, right? And he wants each and every one of us to change his life. And I think we think about this pandemic and what's going on right now. We think about the fact that we all in the house. There's no entertainment, no sports on TV. All the jokers that lay up on the couch and watch football and argue about the Cowboys loss and all that. No basketball, no theaters to go to. We all lay it in the house, right? And I always think about the preoccupation of civilization, and something that's been in my mind, on my heart for a long time, is how we are so preoccupied with things that really of no real material gain for our personal lives. I mean, if the Cowboys win or lose, we really don't gain anything. It's really a big deal for the owners of the team and the players, you know, but it's no big deal for Avery Blaylock. You know what I'm saying? If they win or lose, I could care not. Texans, it really doesn't matter, right? Because there's of no gain for me, right? But because the biggest trick that Satan ever really played on mankind was to keep us preoccupied from the presence of God, right? Because Satan's sharp, right? He's really sharp. He's clever. He know all your plays. He's been watching all your game film, right? So every time you go left, he already sitting there waiting on you. You know what I mean? He's sitting there waiting on you. He know what you like. Satan knows what you like. And only through the word of God can we be able to discern right from wrong, to know when to go left or right, when to know to press the brake, hit the gas. That's exactly what Jesus had in the wilderness, right? In the wilderness, Jesus was in there for 40 days, 40 nights before the devil came and tempted him. He came and tempted him, and he was prepared. You know why he was prepared? Because he had his rod and his staff. And I don't mean physically he had his rod and his staff, but his rod and his staff meaning he knew his Father's word. He knew his Father's ways. He knew his time. He knew he was protected. He was confident. He could maintain his joy. He wasn't working around with happiness, something that's fleeing, something that just occurs. Jesus was in a joyous, peaceful place. He had his full armor on, but his full armor, Ephesians 6:10, was God's word, God's truth, right? And that's what Jesus had in the wilderness. When the devil rolled up on him and the devil say, hey, man, I know you're hungry. You've been in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights with no water, no food, man. You need to turn that rock to bread. Jesus said, man shall not live on bread alone. He said, oh, okay. He got his game plan together. He came back again. He said, and the devil's smart, because the devil said, you know, I'm going to take you on this cliff. I'm going to drop you off this cliff. And matter of fact, that's Psalms 91. The devil knew Psalms 91. And he repeated to Jesus, I'm going to drop you off this cliff. And ain't an angel going to touch you. Ain't your foot ain't going to touch a rock. An angel and your God going to save you. And Jesus said, don't test God. You know what I mean? He didn't tongue wrestle with him or physically wrestle with him. And then the third time, devil came back. Okay, okay, I tell you what. I'm going to take you to the highest point of Jerusalem. You see all those things out there? You see all those things out there? If you see all that, man, if you bow down and worship me, you can have all those things. And then Jesus said, man, you should not put any God before my God. And the thing about it is funny, though, because a lot of people, I always think about that third temptation when Jesus said, when the devil said, if you bow down and worship me, you can have all these things. Because it's funny, because I know a lot of people out there associate material things and money with blessings. That ain't the blessing, brother. Let me tell you, sister, that ain't the blessing. That is not the blessing, because the devil said, if you bow down and worship me, you can have all these things. And we know people that got a lot of material things, and we know they're not godly people. So don't ever parallel material things and money with blessings from God, right? You might be working for Satan, right? You may be working for him, because a lot of people are, don't even know it. They doing his work, don't even know it. Because just like we God's hands, feet, we his mouthpiece, guess what? Some people, devil's hands, feet, and the devil's mouthpiece, right? And don't even know it, because like I say, he's a manipulator. He's going to keep you, he's going to keep that carrot in front of you, those things you like. And you can only discern it if you know God's word. You know, that ain't good. Your spirit going to say, hey, Blake, go left. Don't fall for it. I know it look good, but it ain't good, you know, in the end. It might bring you happiness today, but it ain't going to give you no joy that's going to last, right? So we have to be careful what we associate with blessings, right? Because blessings is peace, joy, contentment, right? The fruits of the spirit, right? Can we all blessing? We all blessed to be a blessing. So anytime somebody bless you, if you're the only one benefiting from it, it's probably not a blessing from God, right? It's not a blessing for God, because every time he bless you with something, it's a bigger blessing behind it, because it's a blessing to be a blessing. It's just like the Dead Sea. The reason the Dead Sea dead is because when the water flows down from the Jordan to the Dead Sea like a cul-de-sac. Nothing flows in or out the Dead Sea. In the Dead Sea, no living thing, living insects or animals live in the Dead Sea. It's real salty. It's a lot of salt, and it's high in mineral content, so nothing can live in the Dead Sea. And the reason nothing can live in the Dead Sea, like I say, it's a cul-de-sac, just like your blessings. So if something flows to you and it stay with you, man, you dead, right? So the reason the Dead Sea is dead, because it doesn't flow out to any other rivers and streams. So we have to make sure whatever comes in his hand, it leave out this hand. And make sure whatever comes in his hand is multiplied through this hand and multiplies our blessings to other people. If somebody give me something, I give it to some man, that makes me feel so good to be able to bless people. To be able to even give a good word, and not just material things. It could be a word. It could be an affirmation. It could say somebody just hello. It could be a smile. It could be opening a door. You know what I mean? It could be something that's really not materially tangible. But you can bless people by uplifting them, speaking positive things in their life. I mean, that's a huge blessing. You know what I mean? That's man, that's nothing more rewarding. I think everybody in this world is looking for affirmation, right? Everybody is looking for affirmation. But anyway, I'm getting to the lesson plan. I was thinking about Paul. Like I said, the people who are just tuning in, we're speaking from Philippians 3:13, where it says, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself have taken hold of it, but one thing I do is forget my past as I press forward towards my future. And I was telling them earlier how this morning when I started my morning devotion in my closet, I went in with this word. You know, I had my plans, and God said, nah, you know, people need something else. You need to explain a little bit more in detail. And what he took me to, in addition to that message, because as we know, you can have the message in the Bible, the authors of these books has one particular message, an intent with this message. But the thing that's so beautiful about God's message is that it might be one intent, but there can be multiple applications, right? So I want to take that same application and apply it to Exodus, right? So we want to get to Exodus. This week I watched, you know, Exodus on TV. I said, oh, okay, so I bought it for like $3.99, watched it for 3 hours, 40 minutes, right? No commercials. And I was looking at it and seeing how it paralleled the Bible. I knew the story, read the story so many times. But it was a lot of significance in Exodus, as even today, because in Exodus, you know, that's where Moses freed his people. They were in bondage for 400 years. And you know the reason they were in bondage for 400 years? Because of disobedience and unbelief. Disobedience and unbelief. And it was funny, I was thinking about that, but in that closet, I said, man, you know what's wild is that? As African Americans here in the United States, guess how long we've been here in the United States? 400 years, 16, 19, 20 ships landed in Point Comfort, Virginia. Point Comfort, Virginia, 2019 made 400 years. So Exodus, 400 years of slavery. And the thing about it is, I know we have physically been in bondage for 400 years. we have, and some of us are still mentally and spiritually in bondage because we don't know God's word, right? And so I thought, oh, the parallel between what's going on with us as a people in Exodus. And then Paul's scripture said, I forget my past as I press forward towards my future. And the beauty in that is a lot of us are still paralyzed in our lives because what? We can't forget our past. We keep looking back. We really think our best days behind us. I know my best days ahead of me because I know God's words and I know God's promises. I know God's word is inerrant, meaning that it's without error. Ain't nothing that he said a lie. He ain't a liar. So all I got to do is do what he said, which is be obedient to his word. I'm not perfect, but I'm not acting as if I laid hold of it, but I'm in pursuit of it. You know what I'm saying? I'm pushing forward. You know, I'm not sinless, but I definitely sin less, you know? And so that's important, man. And I think anytime people can't get their God, say, my people, they'll hear my voice, right? You know, they let those with eyes see, let those with ears hear, right? He said, you know, there could be a millions of sheep out there. But if I'm a shepherd and I got 100 sheep out there, guess what happened? And I'm like, man, I should look at those things and be like, man, that's a million sheep out there. That's wild. How do those shepherds know who sheep those are? How are those shepherds going to ever get their sheep out there? You know how they know? Because God say, my sheep going to recognize my voice. My sheep going to recognize my voice. So when God's word come out, some people be like, oh, man, I don't sweat it. You know what I'm saying? I'm not tripping, man. I'm not trying to force feed you. Because God said, my people, my sheep going to recognize my voice. Let those with eyes see. Let those with ears hear. I'm not finna tongue wrestle with you. I'm not going to physical wrestle with you because it's all unnecessary. You know, we got, like Mother said, we got to push forward. In Exodus, they kept looking back. They like, man, we could have stayed a slave in Egypt for all this, Moses. We should have stayed in Egypt, man, with all of this. He said, my God is the Alpha and Omega. So he created us and he know our first day, our end day. So we just have to believe, right? We have to have faith. We have to see it. Even though we can't grab hold of it, we got to believe it. That's the common thread in all religions is belief, right? Belief, right? It ain't no coincidence, right? So one thing you think about while they were in Exodus all this time, right? Because they was in slavery for 400 years. And the thing that's crazy is that they came out into the wilderness. Moses, you guys know the story. He parted the Red Sea. They went through the Red Sea closed. And when they got on the other side of the Red Sea, they got out, they celebrated, all they partied. They having a good time. Moses, you know what Moses did? And when they went on the Red Sea, what God did was he allowed a covering, right? He had a covering during the day, a covering during the night. In the daytime, he had a cloud to cover him so the sun didn't beat him up because it was over like 2 to 3 million people. In the nighttime, he had the cloud turned to like a light, like fire, so he can get them light so he can lead their way through the wilderness. But the sad part about it is that wilderness trip took them 40 years. Matter of fact, this is what I'm going to do. Anybody could tell me, the first person to inbox on Instagram or comment on Instagram or Facebook, how long that trip should have took them? Because it wasn't 40 years. It wasn't 40 years. How long did that trip take? How long should that trip have taken the Israelites from Egypt to Canaan, which was the land of milk and honey, which he promised to Abraham, right? He promised these things, right? Because even in the wilderness, because of their disbelief and their disobedience, unbelief and disobedience, and keep looking back, God let all those people stay in the wilderness all that time. He brought, like I said, he had the cloud in the day, cloud in the night. He brought manna from heaven. He even brought quails to fall out the sky for them to eat on the ground. He brought the manna down and hit the ground. And when the manna hit the ground, it was like bread, right? They got like free bread. It was just raining bread. So they had food. He let Moses hit the rock and gave him water. And they're like, oh yeah, all is great. All is great. All is great, right? And then the thing about someone said 11 days, right? Okay, that's correct. But anyway, so the thing about it is, while they partying, having a good time, everything was good, Moses went up to Mount Sinai. You know what Moses did in Mount Sinai? Moses went up to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, just like Jesus was in the wilderness. So it's some significance in 400 years in the Bible and also 40 days in the Bible, right? So Moses went up there on Mount Sinai for 40 days. And when he was sitting, he spent 40 days in the presence of God, right? He spent 40, that's like you spending all this time in God's word. Man, if you spend that much time in God's word, when you come out of wherever you at, in your wilderness place, in your closet, you spend some time with God's word, man, you gonna come out there on fire. I've been on fire before, and I wish I just had an audience like this to share it with at certain times, right? But I guess now I do, right? So the thing was, when Moses came down on Mount Sinai, he spent those 40 days and 40 nights, they say he spent so much time with God, he came down, he was so bright. He was the light of the world, right? He was the salt. His face was so bright, he had to wear a veil. They couldn't even look him in the face. He had been that close to God, right? He had explained and came down with those commandments and spent so much meditating on God's word. And for 40 days and 40 nights, he was so bright, man. People couldn't even look him in the face. He was that bright, man. And he came down. But when he came down, guess what the people was doing? They had turned back to the ways. That way they was partying. They had made a golden calf. They were celebrating. And that really is the story of the Israelites, man. That's the story of our people, right? Is that we get preoccupied with things that really aren't as important, right? Like during this pandemic, I think it's a reason, one of the reasons, definitely one of the reasons that this happened is that we can focus once again on what's important, right? Because so many of our people, you know, like I said, man, the Cowboys, little people are like, oh, man, my week going to be bad, man. I can't believe it. I'm like, man, you know, the guys that's out there playing on the field, that's getting the big checks, you know what they doing, man? They in the strip clubs right now. They not even worried about it. And they vested in that team. You're not even vested in that team, and you talking about your week going to be messed up. Man, that's ridiculous to me. But you know what I'm saying? I understand, right? Because like I said, the devil know our game plays, right? And the biggest trick he does is to keep us preoccupied from the presence of God. Because like I said, God says, man, you know his word, man. You're a powerful man. You're a powerful man. When he live in you, when you started exalting God, like you say, you the light of the world. When you start exalting God, guess what's going to happen? God going to exalt you. He going to take you places, man. He going to put you amongst people, man. He going to allow you your life to be touched. He going to allow things that you just going to be like. You're going to have a whole lot of aha moments. Put it like that. You're going to have a whole lot of aha moments, man. And so that's what the devil don't want, man. And like I was telling you, even with me, with my different businesses, God said, oh, I see what you're doing. That's all fine and dandy. But all the stuff you're doing, that's just the wagon. You the horse. You the horse. You have to get uncomfortable. You have to go before people. You have to go what you know you need to be doing. And I knew what he was talking about. I know exactly what I needed to do. And those are the things that, you know, I had. It takes a little courage. Like I said, courage ain't lack of fear. Courage is really moving in spite of your fears, right, man? That's what the definition of real courage is to move in spite of your fears, right? And a lot of people can't do that, man. And fortunately for me, I've had a lot of things in life, you know, from money to women and different things, kind of like Solomon, to say, man, all that stuff did not quench my thirst, man. Really, you know, and I'm so thankful that I had those experiences because I know, not because I read just God's word, but I didn't live Solomon's story, David's story. I ain't killed nobody, but I understand Paul's story. I mean, I see myself in Gideon's story. You know, he didn't beat 130 some men with 300 with very little. He always said, man, you always have enough. You always have enough. You plus God is always the majority, right? Particularly if you connected with him and you have a spiritual connection with him. And so I just want to put that on people's hearts today. I'm thinking about this 400 years of slavery in Egypt and how it took them 40 years. And then something that should have took them 11 days took them 40 years. Took them 40 years, something that took them 11 days. So my point is that what is it that's still taking you all this time to attain, you know, it's taking you years and years to attain, and you're trying to figure out why you can't grasp hold of, why you can't lay your hands on it, why you can't touch it, why you can't feel it. And one of the reasons, because of our lack of faith, disobedience, unbelief, you know, and we have to check ourselves. You can only check yourself. You have a personal, intimate relationship with Christ. That's something that you have to, you know, develop on your own, man. Nobody can give you that. You're not going to get that in the church. A lot of time I go out talking to people and the first thing they say, man, what church you go to? What church you go to? I'm like, man, I love my church, man. But I didn't get this in church, bro. I got this by spending time alone with God. Obedience and sacrifice. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Because the whole thing about the obedience, man, it comes from the heart, man. Anytime things going wrong and people outside of obedience and things outside of God's will, man, everything is always a heart condition. It's always a heart condition, man. It's always God said, God, physical man looks at the outside appearance. They look, oh, he cute and all that. God said, I'm always looking at the heart. What's your intent? Even when we fall, he like, what's your intent? Was he trying to be malicious when he did that? Or did he just make an error? What's your intent? What's your heart like? You know, is your heart soft or is it hard? You know what I mean? I understand this world and these satanic people in this world can, you know, make you act a little ignorant, like you don't know no better at times, you know. But we all slip and fall, and like Paul said, when you fall, man, get up, man, dust yourself off and press forward towards your future, man. It's bright. It is bright, man. I think about, like I said, it's no coincidence about the 400 years. It came to my spirit today, 1619, 20 ships came to Point Comfort, Virginia. and we're here today, right? This was the first African ships in Virginia, 1619. 2019 made 400 years. So this is an Exodus moment for us as African Americans in America. And so what we have to do is, I think the Exodus thing is not just from a physical standpoint, because in physically we free, but mentally and spiritually, man, we still in bondage, you know? And the only way to really free ourselves from this bondage is to know the truth. And the only way to know the truth, the only real truth, is God's word, because his word is inerrant. Inerrant, brother. It's inerrant. No, you can read. Matter of fact, I read a lot of different self-help books, man. I've read so many different books. And you know what? The ones that work, all the self, the secret from years ago, open them, they all on TV there. I said, man, my grandmama taught me that, man, when I was a little kid. It's called faith. Ain't no secret. It's called faith. So all these self-help books that work, they all have biblical principles. I can go through and be like, trash. Oh, that's a good book. It's a good book because it has a biblical principle. Because God said that 1,000 years ago. So it worked then, it worked today, it's going to work tomorrow. So if you apply these principles to your life, it's going to work. This is a guaranteed formula. You know what I mean? This is God's word. It worked years ago. And it's going to work today. It's always going to work, right? Always going to work, man. I mean, so many things. And then I think about this time of year. I'm going to finish with this. I want to talk about this time of year because I talked about a lot of things. I could be all over. I didn't type up a lesson plan like I typically do. But one thing I think that a lot of people don't understand, man, is that this Satan is real, man. He tried to get devil to get Jesus in the wilderness. He on us, man. Out in this world today, in my sanctified imagination, this is like the wilderness, right? This is the wilderness that Jesus was in. And so we out in this world today and we think, oh, man, I know this book. I done read this. Say, man, you got to read that Bible, man. You got to read that book. You got to study that book. You got to understand that book. You got to dig deep in that book. You're gonna dig so deep in it, you're going to start seeing yourself in that book, right? And the thing about it is, this world today is symbolic of the wilderness. And the only way that we can live the life that God wants us to live is to know his word. The only way. That's what protected Jesus in the wilderness when he was tempted. That was his rod and staff. If we don't know God's word, guess what's going to happen? The devil's going to be uppercutting us. He's going to be body slamming us. He's going to be suplexing us, DDTing us. He's going to do all that to us. We're going to be on this roller coaster all our life. Ain't you tired of being on a roller coaster? I want to live like this. You know what I mean? Like that there, right? And we can do that. But the only way to do that is to be on something solid. We can't be on seeking sand. We can't be sitting on seeking sand, right? Because that sand, that's temporary, man. Even the word, oh, I want to be happy. I said, man, you know, the base word for happy is happenstance. Something that just occurs. And if it just occurs, that means that it's just fleeing. But we should be trying to pursue joy. And the only place that we can get joy that can sustain us in times like this, to not to see you panic and, oh my God, worry and yield a little faith, is to know God's word and to know God's promises and to know that we can accomplish all things through Christ that strengthens us, right? He makes us all through the Bible. It says be bold and courageous. It don't say, man, be fearful. No, he say be bold and courageous, right? All throughout the Bible. Put on the full armor of God. All that through the Bible, y'all. I'm just so thankful, man. This is a beautiful thing to be able to do this in your own space. I think we're going to get a little bit more formal with it, but this is my first time. And the thing I think about Blase, when I started Blase, when Blase is mean sophisticated, worldly wise, and one is God. And I'm like, okay, that's cool. That's right. Having worldly understanding and having God, right? Having this relationship, right? I'm like, man, that's a perfect balance. And the logo, like awareness, enlightenment is a full circle. Then it points up to God. And God gave me that, right? And the thing about it, I'm like, man, I need to do more. Because the whole reason I started the club wasn't to be into fashion, was to really promote God's message, right? To use that as a medium for his message. And he's like, no, man, like I said, that's fine and dandy, but that's the wagon. You the horse. You got to get in this word. You got to study this word. You got to show yourself approved. You got to evolve as a person. You got to tell people your story. Matter of fact, I'm putting out a book. It'll be out in July. The plan is July 7th. It's actually called From Fearless and Foolishness to Fearless and Faith, A Journey to Self-Discovery. And all true stories, man. So I just parallel my life to a lot of stories. I'm talking about things nobody know, right? So it's, but like I say, I think when you come in the word, as my pastor say, man, when he jumped in the pulpit, he had to get butt naked. Meaning I got to tell all my truths, man. All my bad stuff, all my good stuff. So years from now, when we come back, people can't say, man, well, that guy used to. Yes, I used to do that. And so Paul used to kill Christians. And he used Paul to write 13 books of the Bible. So there's hope for each and every one of y'all out there. If he can use Paul, he can use anybody, man. He can use anybody. He can use a wretch like me, man. And I'm just so thankful, man. I'm so thankful that he gave me the opportunity to be before you all. And hopefully he give me more opportunities to be before you all. I know he will. I'm just thankful, man. I love y'all, man. I just want to open up any questions, man. I see some questions. Misha, anybody have any questions about anything? I see Gina. Let me turn this like this. My Instagram is sideways. I see you, Dove. Any questions? Everybody good? Come on. I see you, Tisha Smith, Misha Lightfoot, Eureka Johnson. Thank you. Oh, what's up? What's up, my brother? What's up? Harry Trone. Harry Trone. Oh, man. I think. What's up, Sis Nesley? Patricia, what's up, Miss James, Auntie, Felicia, man, I'm trying to think anything that I didn't touch that I wanted to touch, but like I say, I think the significance of, we are in an Exodus moment, right? We just, 2019 made 400 years of us slavery on this planet, on this continent, North America, and so I think we all have to think about what is our Exodus, what is God communicating to us, what does he want us to do, right? Because it's time for us to do something different, man. It's time. I mean, he said, you are the light of the world. We the light of the world. He's the light of the world. It's time for us to be that light. It's time for us to unify. And in this coronavirus epidemic, during this pandemic, you know, it's something he's trying to communicate to each and every one of us. And I know what he's communicating to me is for me to communicate to you guys, to share his word with you guys, man. I do this next Tuesday. Next Tuesday, Lord willing, I'll be here. I think once a week is good. You guys just, you know, I thank y'all for filling me up. Hey, what's up, Miss Tina in New Orleans? Hey, Miss Tina. Oh, boy, Wes, mother-in-law, that's beautiful, man. Tracy, I see you, Wes. I see you, my brother. D, Derek, I need to call you, Derek. But, yeah, man, I just fired up, man. God had me full this morning. Yeah, he had me full this morning, and I just want to thank each and every one of you guys. Thank y'all, man. Thank y'all. Y'all made my day, man. If I don't do nothing else today, man, my day's been blessed by you all's presence, man. What's up, Jason Harrison? I see you, my brother. I appreciate the love, man, because the thing is, like I said, God going to call you. He going to choose you. He going to call you. He going to prepare you, and then believe me, he's going to equip you. So we have to just stand out, man, take that step in faith, just like Abraham. Lots of time with Abraham, when he called Abraham, he said, hey, man, I need you to pack your stuff up and go. Abraham like, where am I going? He said, don't worry about that, man. I'll let you know when you get there. And so I'm going to tell you, that's God's word, man. Pack your stuff up and go. And when you get there, he's going to let you know, man. He's going to let you know you're in the right place because it's going to feel like your seat. You're going to be like, oh, man, this seat feels comfortable. This seat is just for me. And that's how you know, because your spirit going to say, yeah, Misha, that's for me. That's for you. Yeah, Roderick, that's your seat. And you're going to know that seat is customized for you. Yeah, J. Michael, that's your seat. You know what I mean? You're going to know. But we have to be willing to move forward. Move forward for the kingdom. Right now, God need kingdom men, man. There's a lot of chumps out there. You know what I'm saying? Flashy, looking good, but ain't doing no work. You know what I'm saying? Not doing nothing material. You know? And like I said, the biggest trick the devil wants you to do, is to keep you preoccupied from the presence of God. Because in our lives, we're working on businesses. We're working on education. We're raising our kids. We're working on our relationships. We're trying to acquire stocks and property and all this. You know what? God said, man, seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. If you seek him, you're going to be all those things. He said, man, Blake, if you stop focusing on all these other things and you focus on me, man, everything you touch is going to turn to gold. And he had that same message for you. If you focus on him, everything you touch is going to turn to gold. Everything you seek, you're going to find. Every time you knock a door, it's going to answer. Every time you ask, it's going to be given. And that's the truth. That's Matthew 7:33. Seek it. Matthew 6:33 say, seek ye first the kingdom. Matthew 7:33 say, ask. And the thing is, ask, seek, and knock. And it actually spells A-S-K, ask. So you should never forget that. Matthew 7:33, ask. And it'll be given, seek, and you'll find, knock, and the door will be answered, man. Man, I love y'all. I had some music planned on, exit song, planning on playing. But I think my DJ done departed. I'm going to leave y'all with this. This song right here, this song by Travis Green called Respond. Because God is waiting on each and every one of our responses. He said, respond. He says, is there one man Is that one man that's going to stand up and do something different, right? Is that one man going to stand up for my kingdom? Is that one man not going to be scared to go amongst his peers and say, I love God, right? Is that one man, right? Because I tell you what, I can tell. I know who the Cowboy fans, who the Texans fans, who the Democrats, who the Republicans, who like this, who like that. But I'm not sure who all Christians is, my friends. You know, if Satan came back today, would there be enough evidence to convict you as a Christian? Would there really be enough evidence to convict you as a Christian if Satan came back today? I'm not sure. I just want to make sure there's enough evidence in my life. If Satan come, he going to come looking for me. But I'll be ready. Y'all better get ready. Y'all better get ready. When he call you, are you going to respond, man? Yeah. I will respond to you. You got to respond, people. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this time with you and your word, Father. Thank you for this time with your people, Father. It's a blessing. Thank you, Father. I pray that each and every person on the sound of my voice is covered, Father. Each and every person on the sound of my voice, their loved ones is covered, Father. I thank you for the love, Father. I thank you for your mercy and grace, Father. I thank you. Thank you. Elohim, Yahweh God, Father. Your word. Your word is a solid rock, Father. Your word is a fortress, Father. Your word is like a wing, like the wings that cover us, Father. He said you're walking, not get weary. You're running, not get tired, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for empowering me, Father. Thank you for loving me, Father. Thank you for receiving me, Father. Thank you for not forsaking me, Father. I thank y'all, man. I thank y'all. Love y'all. Be blessed.